Hi guys, Nassim here with Photography for Life. Today I'll be doing a video review of the Nikon Z5, a budget-friendly full-frame mirrorless camera that I had a chance to use in the last 4+ months. Now there are many things that I absolutely love about this camera that I want to share with you, but keep in mind that this is not a comprehensive review. If you're looking for in-depth information related to this camera and comparisons to other cameras on the market, then please check out my full review at Photography for Life, the link to which is posted in the description below. Now, what I want to do in this video is go over some of the most important features of the camera and go over things like ergonomics and handling in the field, image quality and autofocus performance, things that actually matter for most photographers out there. Now, if you don't know much about the Z5, it's basically a slightly dumbed down version of the original Z6. Nikon removed some features, changed a few things here and there, which I'll talk about shortly, and used older sensor technology in order to make this a more affordable camera. Speaking of affordability, at $1,399, this is one of the cheapest full-frame mirrorless cameras on the market today, and that's what makes it especially appealing, not just for Nikon shooters, but for anyone who wants to get into a full-frame camera or perhaps explore the benefits of a mirrorless system. So that's something to keep in mind. Now let's talk about things that have changed and things that have not changed. We'll start first with the things that have not changed between the Z5 and the Z6. The 5-axis in-body image stabilization, which works wonderfully, is basically identical to that of the Z6, which is great news. Also, it has the same 273-point hybrid autofocus system that incorporates both contrast detection and phase detection. So that's something to keep in mind. And not only that, but it also comes with all the latest features like animal eye detect and things like that. A lot of the camera features like focus stacking, intervalometer, all those video recording features that you'll find inside these cameras, they're nearly identical. Now, video features by themselves are slightly different, which I'll talk about later, but for the most part, whatever you find on the Z6 in terms of the menu and what's inside the camera, they're basically replicas of each other, and that's great news. Other things that are similar, but not the same. So the 24 megapixel sensor. I said that Nikon used older sensor technology, and that's certainly true. Although it uses the same resolution sensor, it's very similar, a 24.3 megapixel sensor. Because it is a regular CMOS sensor, not BSI CMOS sensor, this camera cannot handle the same readout speeds and other things that are needed for video work. Because of that, this camera cannot record 4K video at full sensor width, something that's very different between the Z6 and the Z5. So something to keep in mind, if you want extra video features, then you might want to consider getting the older Z6 because that has much better video recording capability. This camera clearly was not aimed for videographers. That's why, although it has 4K recording, it is limited to 1.7x crop. So that's something to keep in mind. But in terms of other things like ergonomics, feel, and all the menu systems, they're all the same. So let's talk about ergonomics and handling, because I believe that's a very essential component of these cameras. So when you handle these cameras in the field, you'll notice that Z5 and Z6 have excellent grip. They're comfortable. The button placement is exactly the same as you're used to if you're using a Nikon DSLR. You'll notice that the on-off button, the shutter release, things like the ISO button, exposure compensation, all those things are staying in the same area. Now, the back button placement is slightly different if you're used to a DSLR, but it's not really hard to get used to this new layout. And that's something to keep in mind. By the way, if you are a Nikon DSLR shooter, something that you will be very happy with, you don't have to relearn anything. It's a really easy camera to transition to. Yeah, the buttons might be a little bit different. Some of the autofocus settings might be different, but the menu system is exactly the same. It's all the submenu options are very, very similar. So you don't have to relearn anything. You don't have to understand new things that are in this camera compared to a DSLR. Transition from a DSLR to this camera is going to be super easy. Now, in terms of other features, let's talk about the things that have changed. First of all, if you remember the original Z6 and Z7, Nikon got a lot of heat for not having more than one memory card slot. In fact, the original Z6 and Z7, they only had a single XQD/CFexpress memory card slot, and many professional photographers out there, especially wedding photographers who wanted to use two memory card slots in order to be able to shoot to two cards simultaneously, they chose not to upgrade for that simple reason, and many photographers ended up criticizing those cameras. So Nikon listen to user feedback, and they decided that going forward they'll be incorporating two memory card slots, and as the third full frame camera in the lineup, Nikon decided to incorporate two SD memory card slots, and both memory card slots are UHS-II compatible. So if you buy the latest and greatest UHS-II SD cards with very fast read and write speed, you'll be able to take advantage of them. Another feature that's really new to the Z5 is the ability to power the camera continuously, say in a studio environment, by hooking up an external power source. And if you do that, it doesn't drain the battery, which is great because you can use the camera continuously without having to worry about swapping batteries and things like that, which slow you down. So that's great news. Now let's talk about some of the ergonomic changes between the Z5 and Z6. Now, as I said earlier, Nikon did remove some features from the Z5 to make it more affordable, and one of those features is the top LCD. If you look at the Z6, you'll notice that on the top of the camera there is a top LCD, and that's very helpful, by the way, and I use it a lot to look at the information, especially when you're shooting in the field and you're looking top down at the camera. So you'll notice that this camera not only doesn't have it, but the camera mode dial has been moved from the left side to the right side to fill that empty space. Other than that, the ergonomic and handling differences are very minimal. In fact, if you look at the back of the camera, you'll realize that the button placement between the original Z6 and the Z5, or the newer Z6-II, is basically identical. And that's what makes it great to use this camera for, because if you use it as a backup camera in the field, when you switch between the Z6 and the Z5, or the Z7 and the Z5, whichever one, even the newer generation one, you will not feel any difference in handling and ergonomics. You can actually program these cameras to behave the same way, and you won't even know that you're shooting with the Z5 unless you look at the top of the camera, and that's when you'll see the dial in a different location. Other than that, they're basically the same. Now, there's one feature that definitely stands out between the Z5 and the Z6, and that's continuous shooting speed. Unfortunately, Nikon capped it at 4.5 frames per second on the Z5, which doesn't make it a great action camera when compared to Z6 that can go all the way to 12 frames per second. Now, on one hand, there's good news, and the good news is that even at 4.5 frames per second, the buffer on the Z5 is large enough that if you use a fast SD card, then you can shoot continuously at 4.5 frames per second without having to worry about ever filling that buffer. So that's the good news. The bad news is 4.5 frames per second might not be fast enough for shooting very fast action. So if you do wildlife photography and you want to photograph birds, and there are scenes where birds are taking off or birds are landing, and you want to be able to shoot that as quickly as possible, this may not be a good camera for your needs. Whereas the Z6 and the Z6-II would be much better candidates from that regard. So just keep that in mind. For me personally, it's really not that big of a deal because 4.5 frames per second is fast enough. I usually, even when shooting action, I try to shoot a single frame at a time. But sometimes I must admit there are cases where you have to be able to do more frames, and that's where this camera is going to lack. So if you do landscape photography, street photography, wedding photography, this may not be important at all, but for other types of photography, action, sports, wildlife, that kind of stuff, this camera may not be the ideal candidate. There are a few other smaller things that are different between the Z5 and the Z6, like the LCD on the Z5 has less resolution than on the Z6, but that kind of stuff to me is really not important and relevant because I put the camera side by side, I couldn't even tell the difference. So at the end of the day, if that's important to you, something that you need to keep in mind, but for the most part, most people probably will never feel the difference between the two. While I'm quite happy with the ergonomic design of the Nikon Z5, one of the biggest issues that this camera has, and that's an issue that got inherited from the original Z6 and Z7 firmware, is the inability to turn off exposure overlay when you're using the rear LCD. Basically, you cannot have an uncluttered view of your framing when you're using the LCD screen exclusively. Now, this is not a problem when you're using the electronic viewfinder because Inside the electronic viewfinder, the aspect ratio is different, and that's what allows Nikon to push that exposure information down, and you can see everything clearly without any clutter. But on the rear LCD, you cannot turn that off. And I'll be honest with you, I don't understand how Nikon slipped that through when they initially released these cameras, when there's a button called DISP, and all they had to do is just add one more mode to the button that just removes everything from the screen. And the solution that Nikon came up with on the new Z6II and Z7II is to map a separate button. So you basically have to dedicate a button on the camera to be able to have that uncluttered view, which is very silly. To me, it's not really a solution, it's more of a hack, because I'm ending up wasting a button. And these cameras don't have too many buttons in the first place. So it's unfortunate that I have to dedicate yet another button for that feature if the DISP button is already there. So I don't really understand what the technical limitation of this is, but I've complained to Nikon about it when the original Z6 and Z7 were released. In fact, I wrote about this in my Nikon update firmware wishlist that I published a while ago. And Nikon ended up fixing a number of issues from that list, but this was one of the top priority critical issues that to date has not really been addressed on these cameras. And I would rather have even the ability to be able to map it to a button. That's better than nothing, but I'm losing hope now, because if they provided this as a feature on the Z6II and Z7II, then it's probably not going to be added to the previous generation cameras, which is very unfortunate. So that's probably, I would say, one of my top criticisms of the Nikon Z mirrorless system. I don't understand why Nikon engineering even allowed this to happen in the first place, because this is a very silly issue. It might not be a problem for many photographers out there, but for me personally, I really find that to be an annoying problem. So just keep that in mind. Now, earlier in the video, I pointed out that the Nikon Z5 uses older 24 megapixel CMOS sensor, whereas the newer Z6 and Z6II have PSI CMOS sensors. And you might be wondering what the differences between the two are. And I can tell you, I ran a bunch of different tests using high ISOs as well as tests for dynamic range. And I can tell you that the difference between the two was very, very minimal. In fact, it's so minimal that most people out there will never see the difference. Between the Z5 and Z6II, when I ran high ISO comparison, I was surprised to see that you couldn't tell the difference between the two sensors all the way to ISO 12,800, and only at very, very high ISOs, where it's super noisy, you start seeing the disadvantage of the older CMOS sensor in the shadows and some detail. It has also more chroma noise. So if that's something that is important to you, if you shoot at extremely high ISOs for whatever reason, which is something you shouldn't do, but if you do, then it's something that you need to look into and see the differences for yourself. Now, in terms of dynamic range, if you look at the Z5 performance for its dynamic range, it's actually quite impressive. And I ran a number of tests for dynamic range as well. I tried to recover both highlight and shadow detail, and I could barely see any difference between the Z5 and Z6, or even the newer Z6II. If you are worried about shooting landscapes and you're thinking that the old sensor isn't going to perform, then don't worry about it. It will perform very well. So when it comes to image quality, my conclusion is this camera is phenomenal. High ISO performance is phenomenal. Dynamic range performance is phenomenal. Nothing you have to worry about. And when you post-process images from the Z5, the images turn out great, as you can see in many of the samples that are presented in this review, as well as my written review that I published on Photography Life. You'll be able to see that I was able to work with many different kinds of images, and all of the post-processing worked out really well. I didn't have to worry about too much shadow recovery issues or anything like that. So image quality is just simply phenomenal. Next, let's talk about autofocus. And this is one area where I genuinely believe Nikon should really, really work on. And when I say that, I don't necessarily mean that this is a bad autofocus system. In fact, for certain things, I would much rather use a Nikon mirrorless camera like the Z5 than a DSLR, for example. For photographing people, doing portraiture, night and day difference. I mean, this is great It locks onto the eyes of the subject so well, and the hit ratio is so high that at any point of time, you're gonna get much better results with a Nikon Z mirrorless system. So if you're a wedding photographer, for example, then it's really no contest for, except maybe in very, very low light situations where these cameras can struggle, in most other cases, the autofocus system is going to be much more reliable on a mirrorless camera like the Nikon Z5. But there are certain cases where these cameras suffer, and this is especially when you compare it to other mirrorless systems on the market. Let me give you specific examples. If you have fast action where the subject is moving very erratically and in and out of the frame, for example, or if there is an object in front of or behind the subject that makes it very difficult for the autofocus system to track the subject, or if there are cases where, say, there are birds or wildlife flying or running towards you, in those situations, these cameras can underperform compared to their DSLR equivalents. For example, if you use a camera like a Nikon D500, D850, any of the top-end cameras like D4S, D5, D6, with those cameras, they're designed for fast action photography, and the autofocus system is really stellar. Now, part of the reason is because on DSLRs, you obviously have a completely different system. You have a separate phase detection autofocus sensor, and that's doing all the calculation, whereas here, all the tracking or all the autofocus is taking place on the sensor plane, and the phase detection pixels are located on the sensor. So it's a different technology, and that's a given. But this is one area that Nikon should really have focused on before releasing these cameras. Obviously, as first generation cameras, these are still wonderful. And the firmware updates that we've gotten are also very, very good. Now, if you were to compare it to Canon, when I was using the Nikon Z5 in the field, I simultaneously had the Canon EOS R6, which I'll also be reviewing, by the way. And one thing that really shocked me is how good the EOS R6 was for subject tracking. In fact, I was photographing kind of a nightmarish situation for any wildlife photographer, which is there was a bush with a bunch of leaves in it and branches, and there was a tiny bird that was just hopping from one branch to another. And it was one of those birds that just never sits in one place. An extremely difficult subject to track and photograph. And what shocked me was that with the Canon EOS R6, as soon as I just aimed it towards that bird and I selected animal tracking and prioritization of animals, the camera just found the eye of the bird, which I had a hard time even seeing because in the foliage and the colors of the bird itself, it was really difficult to identify that eye. The camera just locked onto that eye and stayed glued to it the entire time. And that's something that obviously Canon engineers worked on relentlessly until they delivered that sort of result. And to be able to go from average to top of the line in just literally one generation of cameras is beyond impressive. So overall, autofocus performance is great on this camera. Depending on what you're trying to do for portraiture, it's an automatic yes. I would definitely recommend this camera. But for other things like action photography, fast action photography that involves wildlife or very erratically moving subjects, I would say cameras like the Nikon D850, D500, and top of the line cameras like D6 would still be my recommendation at the moment. When it comes to battery life, the Nikon Z5 does not disappoint. In fact, if you compare it to the Z6, you'll see that this has much better battery life. And part of the reason is the new battery. It's improved, it's much more refined. And for that reason, even if you look at the SEPA ratings, you'll see that Nikon says that the new Z5 can take up to 470 shots compared to Nikon Z6 that's limited to 380 shots. Now, in real life, those numbers are going to be different. For me personally, when I was shooting in the field, I wanted to see how many shots I could squeeze out of this camera from a single battery charge. And I realized after I took over 1,000 shots and I still had one battery bar left, I realized that my experience in the field is going to be much more different compared to those SIPA numbers. So that's something for you to keep in mind as well. Now, my use of the camera is going to be obviously different than the way that SIPA tests it. In their use cases, they probably use the EVF and the LCD and the combination of the two quite a bit. Whereas when I'm in the field, I minimize the use of the EVF and the LCD. As soon as I'm done taking a picture, I turn the camera off. I try not to leave those on for too long because that obviously sucks the battery. So that's something for you to keep in mind. Don't think that the number of shots you're able to get from the Z5 is constrained to that 470 number. That's really a reference number based on a particular methodology. It doesn't really reflect real performance in the field. So depending on how you shoot, you might get more images, many more images like I did, or you might get less images. That all depends on how heavy the EVF and the LCD are used. All right, let's go ahead and wrap up this review. As you can see, the Nikon Z5 has a lot to like about. It's a great little camera with excellent image quality, very good ergonomics and handling, and when it comes to camera features such as in-body image stabilization, focus peaking, focus stacking, intervalometer, typical features that you will find on higher-end cameras, they're all in here. Now, is it a perfect camera? No, not really, and it was never designed to be. Remember, at $1,399, this is more of a budget, full-frame, entry-level mirrorless camera. So if you're looking for your first full-frame camera, or you're looking into getting into a mirrorless system, this would be the camera that I can certainly recommend.